Ever seen a hydraulic cylinder drop suddenly? Or a load slowly creeping down even though the valve is centered and nothing should be moving? That's not bad luck. That's a missing or a misadjusted counterbalance valve. Based on viewer requests and popular demand, in this video you'll learn what a counterbalance valve is, why it's critical for safety, how it works, and, most importantly, how to calculate and set them correctly. So let's get started. So what is a hydraulic counterbalance valve? A pilot-operated counterbalance valve is a load-holding valve. Its job is to prevent a load from running away when gravity is helping the movement. It holds the load until the system deliberately tells it to move. Without a counterbalance valve, gravity can overpower the pump. The load accelerates, the cylinder overruns, and you get shock loads or a free-fall condition. But why this happens? Before we continue, this part of the video is sponsored by Brilliant. Brilliant is built around the idea that you are a thinker and a problem solver. You just need the right way in. On Brilliant, concepts that used to feel confusing start to make sense because you're actively working through them, not passively watching. What I like is how you're guided to those aha moments by solving problems yourself. You see how ideas connect, build intuition, and gain confidence in your ability to figure things out. Brilliant also adapts to you. It starts where you are, adjusts as you improve, and challenges you to reach serious learning goals without wasting your time. This kind of interactive problem solving doesn't just help with math or computer science, it trains how you think. And that's a skill you carry everywhere. Because the lessons are short, it's easy to build a daily learning habit that actually sticks, even if you only have a few minutes. You can learn for free on Brilliant for 30 days at brilliant.org/electricallad by scanning the QR code on screen or using the link in the description. Brilliant is also offering Electrical Lad viewers 20% off an annual premium subscription with unlimited daily access. When the directional valve is energized to lower the load, the rod end of the cylinder is suddenly connected to tank. With no resistance in that return path, gravity takes over. The load accelerates, and the motion turns into a free fall, very much like dropping a heavy stone from the top of a mountain. You might wonder why not just use a flow control to slow the free fall. The problem is that restricting the flow creates high pressure at the rod end of the cylinder. If that pressure gets too high, it can damage the rod seals and packing. To exaggerate the effect, imagine the flow control is completely closed. The load is still trying to move, so pressure at the rod end can rise rapidly, easily reaching 1,000 psi, on top of the force created by the weight of the load. With nowhere for the oil to go, all of that force is concentrated on the seals, like a pressure cooker with no relief. Over time, the packing fails, and the cylinder starts leaking. Most equipment that lifts or holds a load, like hydraulic presses, boom lifts, and scissor lifts, relies on counterbalance valves to control motion and maintain safety. It's also important to understand that counterbalance valves are not used only for overhung loads. They're also used in applications where the cylinder is lifting the load, even when the load is not overhung. To prevent the load from dropping suddenly or creeping down when the directional valve is in the center position. Remember, no matter how well a directional valve is designed, it will always have some internal leakage in the center position. That's because the spool seals against the valve body using metal-to-metal surfaces, and that clearance is necessary for the spool to move. Next, let's talk about the different types of counterbalance valves. There are two common types of counterbalance valves. The first is the internally piloted counterbalance valve, which is the most widely used type today. There's no external pilot hose because the pilot pressure is taken internally from the same cylinder port the valve is controlling. As pressure builds at that port, it acts on an internal pilot piston, helping to overcome the spring force and allowing the main valve to open smoothly and in a controlled manner. The second is the externally piloted counterbalance valve. In this design, the pilot pressure is supplied through a separate external pilot line, typically from the opposite cylinder port or a dedicated pilot source. That pilot pressure acts on a pilot piston to help overcome the spring force, allowing the main valve to open in a controlled manner. Now that you understand the different types of counterbalance valves, let's walk through how to calculate and set the correct pressure. We'll start with an overhung load, then move on to a non-overhung load. Overhung loads are common in presses and slightly more complicated, but I'll keep it simple. In our calculations, we're assuming a 4-inch bore cylinder, a 2-inch rod, and a 10,000-pound overhung load. Since the overhung load is acting on the rod side of the cylinder, the pressure acts on the piston area minus the rod area. This effective area is called the annular area. To calculate the annular area, we first calculate the full piston area and then subtract the rod area. Area is calculated using pi times the radius squared. With a piston diameter of 4 inches, the piston area comes out to 12.56 square inches. The rod diameter is 2 inches, which gives a rod area of 3.14 square inches. The annular area is the piston area minus the rod area. So 12.56 minus 3.14 equals 9.42 square inches. Now pressure is calculated by dividing force by area. In our case, the force is the load, which is 10,000 pounds, and the area is the annular area we just calculated, 9.42 square inches. Dividing 10,000 by 9.42 gives us a pressure of approximately 1,062 psi, which is about 74 bar. Therefore, the minimum pressure required for the counterbalance valve is 1,062 psi. However, the general rule of thumb is to set the counterbalance valve at 130 to 150% of the calculated load pressure. In our case, that puts the counterbalance valve setting at approximately 1,600 psi. Now let's calculate the counterbalance valve setting for a non-overhung load. We'll assume the same piston diameter of 4 inches. We've already calculated the piston area to be 12.56 square inches. Using the same formula, pressure equals force divided by area. The minimum load pressure works out to 797 psi, which is about 55 bar. Again, using the same rule of thumb, the counterbalance valve setting works out to approximately 1,200 psi, or about 83 bar. Now that we've calculated the pressure setting, let's talk about how to set the counterbalance valve. To set the pressure correctly, the first step is to install a pressure gauge between the cylinder and the counterbalance valve. Second, if there is a flow control in the system, make sure it is not overly restricted. As a general guideline, it should be no more than about half closed. If the flow control is restricted too much, it creates a pressure drop that will prevent you from setting the counterbalance valve accurately. In most properly designed systems, the pump flow is already matched to the actuator, so a flow control on the rod end port is usually not required. Next, make sure the counterbalance valve spring is adjusted to its maximum setting. This sets the valve to its highest pressure setting, allowing you to safely and accurately reduce the setting during the adjustment process. Now energize the cylinder in the downward direction and monitor the pressure gauge. Adjust the counterbalance spring until the gauge reads the desired pressure of 1,600 psi. There is another valve we need to talk about, the pilot-operated check valve, which is commonly used with a counterbalance function. This valve acts like a brake for the load. When a load is overhung or suspended and the directional control valve is centered, the pilot-operated check valve stays closed, preventing oil from leaving the cylinder and holding the load in position. When the load is commanded to move downward, pressure is applied to the pilot line. This pilot pressure opens the check valve, allowing oil to flow out of the cylinder. Once the check valve is open, the counterbalance valve meters the flow, controlling the speed of the load and preventing it from running away. Sometimes we use a solenoid-operated check valve instead of a pilot-operated check valve. It performs the same basic job, holding the load in place when the directional valve is centered by blocking oil flow out of the cylinder. The main difference is that a solenoid-operated check valve does not use pilot pressure. Instead, the solenoid must be energized at the same time as the directional control valve. When the solenoid is energized, the check valve opens and allows oil to flow so the load can move. If this video helped, give it a thumbs up. It really supports the channel. And for more clear, real-world hydraulics, hit subscribe. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.